back to 237, back with another review. Now, this is another film that I picked up recently when I bought a stack of cheap titles. And this is a film that I've seen before. I saw it years and years ago. I don't even remember at what point I saw it. But recently, I reviewed 1978's Magic with Anthony Hopkins, and someone mentioned this film in the comments. So the next time I went to the store and I saw it there for $3-4, I thought, well, I guess it would be a good time to talk about it. And it is a horror film. It's a psychological horror drama, but I feel like most of the horror aspects is put into the marketing. Because when I hold this up, it's going to look like a horror film, and it's sold as a horror film, but it definitely, it does feel more of a drama, and eventually even like a courtroom, a melodrama. But it's a film from 1977, also with Anthony Hopkins. That's why someone mentioned it in the comments. And it is a film directed by Robert Wise, who directed the original Haunting, which is a haunting film that I'm a fan of. And it's 1977's Audrey Rose. Yeah, this is just a cheap MGM DVD. And actually, it's based on a novel by Frank DeFelitta, who, I mean, he wrote the novel The Entity, which would become the 1982 film that I'm a fan of. He directed Dark Knight of the Scarecrow, which is one of my favorite TV movies. So, I mean, that director, based on that guy's book with Anthony Hopkins. And this kind of story could be interesting, but I mean, like, this definitely makes it look like a horror film. A terrifying tale of soul possession. The girl kind of looks like Linda Blair to an extent. And I think what they were going for was, because I have seen this compared to, in some ways, The Exorcist. Only because it does deal with a heavy religious aspect, in that case possession, this case reincarnation, centered around this young, you know, all-American regular girl, your average everyday girl. But, you know, taking place in the city, a modern city, and a modern, most realistic depiction as possible. And I do kind of see it that way. It is kind of like, oh, it's The Exorcist done, but with reincarnation instead of possession. Only it's not, and then eventually turns into the courtroom drama and becomes more about the point of view of the parents. Like, if you were these parents, how would you handle this situation? The girl kind of takes a back seat. And I'll get into that. But, and of course, like always, Anthony Hopkins gives an excellent performance. Now, for the second half of the film, he doesn't really get to act at all. I mean, once the courtroom stuff happens, he mostly just sits there. I mean, there are scenes where he reacts and he cries, but I mean, it's really the first half where he gets to act. And as always, he does do a great job. It's Anthony Hopkins. I would say he does get to shine more in a movie like Magic or The Elephant Man, both of which I think are stronger performances and films. Also stars Marsha Mason as the mother, Janice, John Beck as the father, Bill, and Susan Swift plays Ivy / Audrey Rose, which, this was her first role, and the only other thing I've seen with her, which was actually her last role. She's still alive. She just retired. Is Halloween 6. And that movie's so forgettable, I don't even remember who she is in that. And she does all right. I mean, when she's having her terrors and nightmares, and like when Audrey Rose is coming through, yeah, she does fine. But in scenes with regular dialogue, I guess when she's normal, she's all right. But when she's like concerned or scared or worried, it does feel like a child actor performance. There's not much to it. But I thought the parents did fine. I mean, there's not much to their characters. I guess you could say the mom has an arc, going from skeptic to fully believing. The father is just skeptic and angry throughout the film. Directed by Robert Wise. Is there really anyone else worth mentioning? And then, like, the supporting cast, like the lawyers and doctors, I mean, they do fine. Other than that, music was done by Michael Small, cinematography, Victor J. Kemper. There really wasn't anything, like, cinematography-wise. I mean, I do like how the scenes in the apartment are shot. I mean, it's like this big, open, high-ceiling apartment. And it's usually shot from like a wide angle, so you can really feel the space of the room. But there is one scene I really enjoyed, which is, you know, she has these night terrors where, which I'll get into, where she's just thrashing around. And of course, they don't want to wake her up and shock her. But we've seen it a couple times, and then this really bad incident. It's all shot from outside. We just hear the rain, the thunder, the music. We don't hear any of the screaming or anything. We're just watching through the windows. It's like this tracking shot from window to window. And just seeing Janice try to, you know, help her. I thought that was very well shot. Oh, and Ivy is just now turning 11. Or getting ready to turn 11, and every year on her birthday, around her birthday, she has these night terrors. But they both notice that there's this guy with a beard that shows up everywhere and follows them throughout town. And eventually, the guy calls and sets up a meeting, and it's Anthony Hopkins. And he explains that, you know, it took like 7 years of me researching you and making sure everything was true and perfect before, you know, I met you so I could be sure. And he explains that, because the opening scene is like a POV of a car, like from the grill of a car, just smashing into another one. And then we get the opening credits, which is basically, again, Rosemary's Baby credits, set without the little girl singing. And again, I think that's how they want to market it, is like an Exorcist kind of Rosemary's Baby kind of horror film. But really, just the night terrors are really the only horror scenes, really. But he says that his 5-year-old daughter died in a car accident on this date. They say that's Ivy's birthday. He says she died at like 8:20 a.m. or p.m. Ivy was born at 8:22 on that day. So he's trying to say that, you know, while his wife died and passed on, Audrey, her soul is trapped and went into Ivy's body. She's reincarnated. The dad does not believe it whatsoever, and he wants Hopkins to stay away from him. But Janice is kind of open to it, and then one night specifically, the dad is working late. That's when she has that really bad terror. Hopkins is already down at the door getting buzzed in. She lets him in. He helps her. He helps calm her down. And then he just starts explaining everything more to the mother. And there are very lengthy dialogue scenes about, you know, like their first meet, Hopkins giving him their history, about like what happened to his family, how he came to, you know, he saw this psychic, then he saw this other psychic, and then, you know, he, pretty much how he started following him. But now during this scene, he's explaining reincarnation as best as he can, and how he went to India, and what the Dalai Lama believe. It does get very in-depth. It's a very dialogue-heavy film. And yes, this does run 1 hour 53 minutes, and it is a very slow burn. But it doesn't quite have those horror scenes that, like, The Exorcist does. And yeah, Rosemary's Baby may run a similar amount of time, and it's all building up to like that last scene, but at least Rosemary's Baby, you still have like that dread of just unease and paranoia that just builds up until you get to that last scene. And then eventually, Hopkins and Janice kind of make a pact to help her. I mean, he doesn't want to take Ivy away from them, but like he still wants to be part of her life and be able to help with the night terrors. Of course, the dad's not cool with that. At one point, she's having another one. There's an altercation between Hopkins and the dad in the hallway. I don't remember exactly like who got there first or whatever. But Hopkins is able to get in, locks them out. They get the cops and a pass key, but they find out that he's rented a suite upstairs and that he's taken her to his suite and that she's asleep. He gets arrested for kidnapping, and you get this trial where the trial isn't about kidnapping. The trial is about proving reincarnation and that Audrey Rose is the reincarnation, or that Ivy is the reincarnation of Audrey Rose. And yeah, that's where the movie really kind of gets more tedious. I mean, it is an interesting concept. It does have that sort of Exorcist slow burn kind of build to it in the first half. But it feels like, it feels like if you're watching The Exorcist and then early on, like say right after that scene when she when she's going up and down in the bed and everything's flying around, if it became like a courtroom thing to prove exorcism. And yeah, to shield her from the public eye, they send her to a Catholic boarding school. Not the best boarding school. 'Cause I don't know if this is a boarding school tradition or just a tradition specific to this school, but they build a giant snowman and then have like a fire around it, and they sing the song about Father Time going away early spring. And at this point, it's known that Audrey Rose, after the car after the initial crash, the car caught on fire. So she's pounding on the windows to get out, and then she burnt. So that's why when she has these night terrors, she always goes up to the window to bang around, or she's constantly banging around. Actually, even during one night terror, she's banging on a window. Actually, it's during this scene, and she burns her hands. Or when they put her back to bed, her hands are burnt. And the dad thinks it's the radiator. The mom says it was a cold window. It has to be something that Hoover, which is Hopkins' name, you know, It's unexplainable. There's got to be some weight to what he's saying. And that's early on in the film when her hands get burnt. So I thought it was going to be more of like this exorcist type movie. Because there's very little that I remembered about this the first time I saw it. I actually really only remembered a few scenes. I remembered like the first meeting with Hopkins at the restaurant. And then a couple scenes with him at the apartment. And then the scene with the snowman fire, where she looks at the fire, and there's a nun upstairs watching, and then there's a nurse outside with the girls, but they have a fire on the premises. Like, that's the 70s. She sees the fire, and she's in a trance, and she just, like, walks towards it, then crawls on it. Then she gets sent to the hospital. And, yeah, I mean, I can definitely see people. It is a decent movie. It's well acted. It is well written. It is an interesting story. It is an interesting way to take a reincarnation story. You know, sort via Exorcist in the most realistic way possible. I mean, there's even a hypnosis scene, like in The Exorcist. But, yeah, well, what's the... I really like courtroom movies, but I feel like that's where most of the horror stops, except for, like, the scene with the bonfire and then the end with the hypnosis. Because the mom does take the stand, and in her testimony she says that she's now a believer of Hoover, and that Ivy is the reincarnation of Audrey Rose. The dad gets pissed. Their lawyer suggests hypnosis to see if that proves anything. And the ending is kind of... It doesn't really say. But... Yeah, so they hypnotize her, they got the jury, they got Hopkins, they got the dad behind a two-way mirror. The guy hypnotizes her, takes her back through different stages of her life, and then before she was born. And of course, it's like a night terror where she's just thrashing around. He tries to snap her out of it, but he can't. This is when Hopkins tries to help, and he smashes through the glass. But then Ivy loses consciousness and dies. It doesn't really say how. I mean, I'm guessing it was when Audrey's soul crossed over, Ivy died as well. I'm not really sure. It doesn't really say either, but she dies in his arms. Wow. Also, during the trial, like a member of the Dalai Lama comes in to again explain reincarnation, and we get like sort of documentary footage of ceremonies in India. Again, I guess trying to add to that sort of realistic documentary feel that Friedkin tried to do with The Exorcist. And then it ends with a quote. You know, it ends with her writing a letter to Hopkins saying how much she believes, and, you know, she's not sad that Ivy's dead. She's sad that her body's gone, but she now believes that her soul lives on forever. Mentions that the husband doesn't, but... And... I mean, it's not a bad movie for what it was. I feel like this should have been marketed differently. I mean, the poster that you saw in the thumbnail does make it look very Exorcist, Rosemary's Baby, or Omen looking. This does make it look like a 70s horror film. I mean, this just looks like something from The Exorcist. A terrifying tale of soul possession. And maybe more of the horror is just, what if you did have this ideal life and then you find out your kid isn't necessarily who you thought she was? There's, you know, there's someone else in there, and it could jeopardize your child's life. I guess that's more where the horror lies. And I think for a lot of people, I mean, I've had people say that Carrie isn't a horror movie. I've heard people say The Exorcist isn't a horror movie because of how slow it is. And, you know, there's horror elements because there are very few scenes. I'm not going to take away the genre from this film. Yes, it is a psychological horror drama, but I do feel like it is heavier on the drama, and the face value and the marketing isn't quite as honest. I mean, if you were to pick this up and read it, you would probably think you're getting another exorcism movie. But I mean, it is interesting. It's an interesting way to tackle the reincarnation aspect. It is kind of obvious that the book came out after The Exorcist as well, that they are kind of going for an exorcist kind of route, that ultra-realism, modern-day city, young girl, all the way down to the hypnosis. But I figured they could have done more with, you know, instead of just these night terrors, you know, what if when Hopkins calmed her down, she did talk to him, say things that Audrey would have said to him when she was alive? You know, really make it seem like there is some other girl inside of her somewhere. Other than just this screaming and thrashing. And yes, I know the girl was 5 years old. Audrey was. She's supposed to be like 11 or 12. But, and really, what makes this movie grind to a halt once you get to the courtroom half is the lack of Anthony Hopkins. I mean, even if there are scenes that kind of drag, whether it be him telling his story or explaining reincarnation, his performance is what makes it work. I mean, his presence is very strong as well, even when he's just sitting in the courtroom. But his performance definitely is the shining jewel of this film. It almost always is. But, yeah, I do feel like this is one of those cases where it's kind of one of those Trojan horse horror movies. It's definitely more of, definitely feels more like a drama, or maybe the horror is more emotional than it is visual and visceral. But I mean, it's still a decent movie. Definitely not my favorite from Hopkins or Wise. I would say my favorite Robert Wise film is still The Haunting. Hopkins, Silence of the Lambs, still my favorite, but also Elephant Man and Magic, I would put over this. But it's still decent. I mean, I'm glad I own it. I'm glad I saw it again. It is kind of like if you take The Exorcist, the original one, and Exorcism of Emily Rose, because of how they're trying to prove, like in that, they're trying to prove exorcism and possession is real. But like, in The Exorcist, like, if after the hypnosis scene, it went into the courtroom stuff. Even though the hypnosis is after the courtroom in this. But, I mean, there's not much to say about it. But, yeah. And other than Hopkins, I mean, I guess the cast did fine. Especially Marsha Mason. Everyone else did fine, but they're really one-note characters. I do think they could have done more to sort of show that there's some other spirit in her other than just these night terrors, but I get they're going for realism, but anyway, that's 1977's Audrey Rose with Anthony Hopkins. Not my best review. I guess there just really wasn't much for me to say about it, but anyway, thank you for watching.